they gon' get the word today. I send a text back, never curb the fate. Jesus, curses break, slaves get freed in the worst away. Ever see that dope dealer, cold killer, gold brilla crying on the floor with us? Cause your hope hit him, had a hole in him, now he got a hole in it. Tell him the Dead Sea here, we the new Israel, Israel, God really lives here. Watch the sin here, way more than dead, we begin here. We begin here. I put my hand on the Bible, the Lord is my witness, that KB is closer than blood. I got that HGA tatted right next to my heart, so you know it's gonna always be love. Don't need no contracts or labels, you know we got them, a seat at my table. Hovey little bro, so I'm willing and able. I keep some riders at home in the stable. Whoa, 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 I done told it all, but I still got more. Remember when the folks got killed next door? Partner told me, sell pills, not blow. Shorty told me, my career won't blow. Swear I don't care about the status. Why would I clout chase when God is my daddy? Take all my records, my money, my Grammys, I'm still gon' die richer than you can imagine. Jesus the King, I'm his prophet. Send me to Nineveh, I get it poppin'. They see an interview, swear I ain't with it. I say, come see what I do in my city. From coolin' with Kendrick to walking through Romans with people in prison. Let me stop talking, cause man, I've been did it. Can't let my left hand on my right position. Y'all just gon' have to see when I transition. I can't tell it all, man. Let's go.
I don't do the most, but I do a lot. I'ma make a toast, cause we still alive. No big, I feel like Pac. I shoot a shot, I'm coming in hot. Well, I got the steamer. I bring the fire, but you never seen her. I testify, I don't need a subpoena. They want my soul, better go to Korea. I love my dog just like I'm Peter. Gotta protect him. I made the call, it was just like I'm reffing. I know we left, yeah, now we back together. But I guess that is better now, later than never. Like, what's happening? I'ma need y'all, quit asking when. Me and my wife gonna have some kids. Right now, we just practicing. Practicing. Teacher said, quit rapping, man. That gonna hurt my average. I said, thank God I ain't average. Yeah, I'm a bright young man. Yo, the GPA, and the BPM. Look, we on. So say what you say, cause that's A with Lecrae. From the A train to the A, I'm coming in hot. I don't do the most, but I do a lot. I'ma make a toast, cause we still alive. No big, I feel like Pac. I shoot a shot, I'm coming in hot.
Wake 'em up. Wake 'em up. See, I'm still sleeping, so I had to shake 'em up. I kept it too real. I wasn't faking up. My real life was a headline. Your real life got a deadline. My timeline was a hashtag. Your timeline just a hate crime. Coming in hot, feeling like Pac. Back in I-4 when he took 5 shots. Too much drive to ride your wave. Ditch my top and I'm off that lot. Black on black on black on black on black on black on black. You don't have to ball a rap to get them racks on racks. Uber poolers trying to catch my vibe and find my way. Yeah, I know I'm ratchet, but I'm really safe. Hot sauce dripping. Everybody wanna start dipping. First, nobody wanna listen. Now everybody pay attention. Now everybody pay fee. Even Trump gotta take a knee. When the horn blow, y'all gon' see. Make the wall fall down like, yee. I don't do the most, but I do a lot. I'ma make a toast, cause we still alive. No big, I feel like Pac. I shoot the shot. I'm coming in hot.
Coming in hot. Coming in hot. Shoot that shot. Shoot that shot. Shoot, why not? Hey, why not? Ain't no big. Ain't no big. Feel like Pac.
Feel like Pac.
We can't lose. We can't stop.
We can't stop.
Yeah, coming in hot. Coming in hot. Coming in hot. Coming in hot. Shoot that shot. Hey, why not? Hey, why not? Hey, watch out.
Child, you are enough.
can't afford ya. I still pours up lavishly upon ya. It makes his love, he shines so bright upon you, you. I will be content, cause I know you would never fail me. Even when my knees are shaking, even when my heart is bleeding, no. Oh, valley, when I walk in the midst of the valley, my life's in the hands of my daddy.
I'm already loved, I'm already chosen.
Yeah. So for this life, I know the goal, no. Me, I know this soul. Cause my jive and I my party. Hey, to man, I need go.
Peace, you give me purpose, my provider. And when my enemies surround me, got me tied up. When they throw me in the pit inside the fire, you are my God and my King and my Father. Light to my path in the darkness, hope in my heart. When they heartless falling, you reach out and caught us. You're the lover of my soul, love is flawless. They don't understand my goddess.
Keeping me high, I know they go low. Cause me, I know they soul. Cause my jive and I my body. It's a man and he go. You
me whole again. It's all worth it in the end. But when you got nobody to turn to, just hold on and I'll find you. I'll find you. I'll find you. Just hold on and I'll find you.
I'm hanging on by a thread, and all I'm clinging to is prayers. And every breath is like a battle. I feel like I ain't come prepared. And death's knocking on the front door. Pain's creeping through the back. Fear's crawling through the windows, waiting for them to attack. They say don't get.
Mother in a church hat clap, man, that shook every color purple coming back clap. When that whole week beat you up and stress you, but you hear that organ playing and remind you of your blessings. And on another note, she just hit another note. Chills down my spine, got me crying, make me overload. You don't know about it though. Old school church hymns, deacons get the humming out of drum, I'm finna burst in.
Lordy, Lordy, Lord.
Can you hear me now? Church close, sweater, you don't care, you just. How we made martyrs out of these fathers and rose up all of his daughters to glorify him with honor. Man, I swear Simon Jones with a head did. Now it's flying everywhere, she don't care what her head did. She an egg, yeah, caught up in the egg, yeah. Finally, why she clapping like Jesus just reappeared, yeah.
Give me that God Almighty, that God old Bible, that old school doctrine. Give me that truth for the body, ain't nothing new about it, but it's still on the power.
To get the Lord on his feet, I wanna do the type of shows that the Lord wanna see. What I mean, if I can make the whole church clap, but ain't a clap in the heavens, then that clap just a clap, clap. For a son glorified, sin mortified, the Holy Spirit going word that truth ain't more than that. It's sound doctrine, gets birthed in the coming out. Nothing wrong with singing loud, but that ain't where the power's coming. On the church, church has been clapping at weak sermons, leaving the weak hurt, no one's changed by Sunday service. Need discernment, check what you be affirming. Cause the church can be full of members, but empty in conversion. Preach the gospel and stand back. Look for changed lives, not for head class. Love people well, oh they can't stand at the church. Just the church with the words where we stand at.
What is up, guys? How are you tonight? You guys doing all right? For the most part, thank you. Thank you, Carter. Thank you, Carter. Well, hey, as we get started, we need to start by honoring and celebrating a certain someone in the room who happened to have the best bracket out of our entire tournament challenge bracket competition this year, and it is none other than Dawson Pruitt. So Dawson, go ahead and stand up. Let's give him a round of applause. Well done, Dawson. Well done, Dawson. He crushed it. He is the winner of our tournament, and he and I are in conversation about his prize, so don't worry. Don't worry. Conversation is underway. Deliberations and negotiations are currently underway, and we will finalize the deal before the end of the night. So, but in all seriousness, welcome, guys. We are so glad you're here. We're going to jump right into things, but before we do, I want to just take a moment. And I know you guys have had a lot going on this week. I know that the end of the school year is right around the corner. You guys are moving towards finals. There's a lot going on. And I just want to take a moment because I had a unique conversation with my parents today. And I think this is a great thing for us to have in our minds as we get ready to spend time worshiping God and then studying His Word. So I have a little brother, his name is Jake, and he lives in Austin, Texas. And so this past week, my parents drove down to Austin to not only celebrate his birthday, which was on Monday, but also to experience, to witness the solar eclipse. Just out of curiosity, did anybody else have family members who were able to experience the totality? Okay, a couple of you. And the backstory is my dad loves space. Like, is a huge, huge space nerd. He minored in astronomy in college, and so growing up, whenever we'd go to the mountains, my dad was always quick to point out constellations and point out planets, and just was always encouraging us to consider the grandeur and the glory and the wonder of space. And so my dad, I just talked to him this afternoon, and my dad and my mom were talking about their experience of totality. And what they talked about is that it truly was a life-changing experience, which to me sounds a little silly, to be honest. It's like, well, yeah, it got dark. it got dark, and that's kind of it. But what they shared is that it truly was a life-changing experience and an eye-opening experience, because it was so different from anything that we could possibly experience in life. And what they then talked to us, the reason for it being this out-of-body sort of experience, where my sister-in-law was there as well, and she said she just got chills instantly and started crying uncontrollably. My dad shared that before he knew it, his hands were raised in the air, just saying like, wow, can you see this? Like, can you imagine what this is actually like? Just kind of a mind-blowing experience. The reason for this is because we serve and worship a really big God. Amen. We serve an incredibly powerful, awesome God. Amen. And he is the God who has orchestrated everything to work the way that it works. And my parents just had an opportunity just to have a small, small glimpse of his grandeur, his glory, and his beauty as they experienced a total solar eclipse just a couple days ago. Now, I want you guys just to take a moment and think about what has been a God moment for you this week? What's been a moment for you this week where you're saying, okay, God, I see you there. I can see your love. I can see your care. I can see your grandeur. I can see your glory. Because that's who we're going to worship now. That's who we're going to worship now. So just take a moment. Take a deep breath if you need to. Take a moment to be still, to be quiet. And if you would, please pray with me now. God, we thank you for the opportunity we have to gather together as your people, to spend time worshiping you through song, to spend time studying your word, to spend time in small groups later. God, we're just grateful. We're grateful for who you are. We're grateful for your power, for your grandeur, for your glory. God, I'm grateful to hear just a small glimpse of what that experience was like for the total eclipse, Lord, and just a small piece of recognizing just how powerful and mighty and majestic you are. And God, we are so small, but you are so great, and we just thank you for this opportunity we have now. Quiet our hearts, quiet our minds, help us to be present and aware of what you might be trying to teach us, you might be trying to shape us or form us tonight. God, we pray this all in the name that is above all names, the name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen.
Lost in darkest days, drowning in shame, will I seem lost? Stuck in desert days, till mercy came and saved my heart. Far as east from west, you took my past and shattered it. Grace I don't deserve, you loved me first, my soul will sing. God is faithful as the sunrise, surely you'll never leave. In your goodness lasts a lifetime, the promises you have for me are forever captured. Lord, you're constant as the sunrise. hand has carried me. Here I found my home, where I belong, forever free. Far as east from west, you took my past and shattered it. Grace I don't deserve, you love me first, my soul will sing.
Your name stands above them all. you are holy. High school, would you just tell him that right now? God, you are holy. You are above all things. You are knowing of all things. And for that, we trust you, God. Help us to trust you deeper. Help us to follow you closer. Lord, we love you. We trust where you're taking us. You're faithful. It's in your name. Amen.
All right, some of you know this about me, some of you may not.
Yeah, Carly.
Hi. Hi, everybody. Good to see ya. I am married. Your girl is off the market. Been married for 5 years. And thank you. Appreciate that. I am married to the best guy you could ever meet. I love him. His name is Andrew. He is great because he gives me a lot of grace. And I need a lot of grace. I am a very emotional girl. If you know me, you probably know that. I feel my emotions really strongly. Like, if I am happy, I am so happy. If I am sad, I am devastated. The world is about to end. Everything's crashing around, down around me. If I'm angry, I'm furious. And as you can imagine, this has caused a little bit of tension in my marriage every once in a while. Yeah, the person who is most affected by those swings and emotion that I have is definitely Andrew. And when I am in that like emotional tornado that I get in so often, I can say some things that I really don't mean. I'm sure maybe you guys have experienced that before. Like, we can say the harshest, cruelest, worst things to the people we care about the most. And I'm regularly blown away in those moments when I'm coming at Andrew with all my anger. When he greets that with just love and kindness, it really throws me off. Like, it's disarming. I expect him to meet me at that level, right? To yell back at me, to get so angry. Instead, he says things like, I love you, or I'm sorry if he dropped the ball. Isn't that the best? Isn't he the best? And it's in those moments when he greets my anger with his love and his grace that I'm really motivated to change. I'm motivated to change. Because I wanna be like the best wife to that guy who shows up for me when it's not fair, right? I wanna meet his kindness with kindness, because that's what grace does. Grace motivates us to change. It makes us wanna get better. So I want you to think, when is a time in your life when you felt called to a higher standard? Where was a time in your life where you felt called to a higher standard? Maybe it was in sports. You showed up to practice one day or a game and you realized like, oh man, I am not as prepared as I should be. My team is suffering because of my lack of preparation. You felt motivated to change. Or when was a time that you felt motivated by grace to change? Maybe there was a time where you really messed up and your parents or your friends didn't punish you in the way that you deserved, right? They met you with kindness instead. When were you motivated by grace to change? This is so often what it looks like in our relationship with Jesus, guys, right? Because his grace, what he accomplished to such a greater degree of anything else that we experience on this earth, that level of grace, like him dying for you, sacrificing everything for you, that kind of grace changes us. I would argue that kind of grace has to change us. There's no way to have an interaction, a relationship with that kind of God, with that kind of love, an unthinkable love, and not be changed, right? Jesus' grace changes us. Romans 2 tells us that the kindness of God is meant to lead us to repentance. There is no way to not be changed by that kind of God. We were designed to be changed. We were designed to bear fruit. And that's what we're gonna be talking about today. So let's start in Galatians 5:13. It says, you, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh.
Rather, serve one another humbly in love. For the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command: love your neighbor as yourself. If you bite and devour each other, watch out, or you'll be destroyed by each other. I want to lean into that verse that says, do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh, but serve one another humbly in love. What does this mean? I think so often, as Christians, we just take the love and the grace of Jesus Christ for granted. I know I do, right? Or we even use it to justify our sin, to tell us that it's okay, right? Jesus loved me. He sacrificed everything for me. I'm a part of his family, so it's okay if I keep stepping into this sin, even though I know it's wrong, right? If I were to put it in the context of my marriage, Andrew locked it down. He married me. He made that choice, right? So I can keep saying and doing these things that I know are hurtful to him because I have security and confidence in my relationship with him. But this is so not the way that we were called to live, right? The grace of Jesus, the freedom that he provides us, should not be the reason that we keep sinning. It should be the motivation for becoming more like him and loving others well. I'm going to read that again. The grace of Jesus, the freedom that he provides us, should not be the reason that we keep sinning. It should be the motivation for becoming like him and loving other people well. Jesus' grace changes us. Let's keep reading in verse 16. So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what's contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what's contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you're not to do whatever you want. But if you're led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. This part of the passage starts leaning into the essential, important role of the Holy Spirit when it comes to the change that we experience as followers of Christ. The great news is, as soon as we say yes to Jesus, we are given the gift of the Holy Spirit, God in us, and he immediately begins the work of forming us into people that look more like Christ. He begins that work in us. Because here's the reality. We cannot create that change in ourselves. We don't have the power to do that. We don't have the ability to create fruit in ourselves, but the Holy Spirit helps us. That conviction that you feel, I know you felt it, that feeling in your gut that's like, what I am doing is wrong and I know it. That is the Holy Spirit working in you. That tension that you feel between what you want for yourself and what God wants for you, that is the Holy Spirit working in your life. Jesus' grace inspires us to change, but we're not alone as we pursue that change. It's just our responsibility to listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit and walk with him as he guides us and bears fruit through us. Last week, Stephen talked in John 15 about the vine and the branches, right? That were that, if you think about an orchard, you know, all those rows of grapes, or the bushel of, it was like my favorite thing when my mom would put grapes in my lunchbox in school. I just love grapes, a good crunchy grape. So if you think about like that bushel of grapes, we're that like flimsy stick, that flimsy little twig that the grapes are attached to, right? In our own right, we don't have the strength to even support the weight of the fruit. We can't create that fruit in and of ourselves. All of the power comes from the vine. All of the power comes from the vine, and the vine is Jesus Christ. Jesus' grace changes us. Jesus' grace and the Holy Spirit's work in us, the vine, is what creates the fruit. So we're going to lean more into what that fruit looks like. So let's keep reading in verse 19. The acts of the flesh are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity and debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, which means patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. And just a side note on that, guys, those lists of qualities, they can be called vice and virtue lists, if we're going to lean into some like biblical logistics. Basically, those aren't meant to cover like, hey, this is all of the sins that you could possibly commit, and this is all the ways that God is able to work in your life, right? They're not extensive in that way. They're more designed to paint an overarching picture for us, to give us an overarching view of, hey, this is what a life with Jesus looks like versus a life apart from Jesus. And a life with Jesus, guys, is a life that bears fruit. It is a life that bears fruit. A person that has encountered Jesus and accepted him is a person that is actively being transformed into someone that demonstrates who he is. A person that has encountered Jesus and accepted him is a person that is actively being transformed into someone who demonstrates who he is, someone that demonstrates those qualities: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. And walking with the Spirit, it means better showing these qualities, these characteristics, taking steps forward in these qualities more and more, partnering with the Holy Spirit, until we join Christ at eternity. It's an ongoing process of change. It's an ongoing process of change throughout our whole lives. Let's pick up in verse 24. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Remember that. We're going to come back to that phrase, keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking, and envying each other. This is a big statement made in verse 24. It says we're called to crucify the flesh. Crucify. It's not a coincidence that that's the same way that Jesus died, right? In the same way that Jesus sacrificed himself, we are called to put to death those sinful desires that can drive us. And on this earth, on this side of heaven, right, we know that there's a life after this, but on this earth, death is the clearest example we have of something that is final, right? Over and done. And we should be looking at this verse in that way. We are called to put to death, never to let those things drive us again, because walking with Jesus is not a both and situation. It's not a both and. It's okay, over here, I'm going to say yes to Jesus. I'm going to let Jesus guide my life. And also over here, I'm going to let my sin kind of drive my life too. You can't say yes to both things. It's an either or. It's you choose Jesus, you choose his way, or you choose your way. And you experience the consequences that come with living a life that you weren't designed to live. So we know that Jesus' grace changes us. We know that we're designed to bear fruit. And it's by the power of the Holy Spirit and our connection to the vine that that fruit develops in our lives. But let's cover some important questions that can pop up as we look through this passage. Some important questions. I think the first one is, why does fruit matter? Why is this included in the Bible? Why is fruit important? I think it's for a few different reasons. The first, the fruit of the Spirit reveals God at work in us. The fruit of the Spirit reveals God at work in us. If you think back to my example with my husband, every time that I choose to love him instead of let my emotions drive my actions, every time that I choose kindness instead of my anger, that is a demonstration of my love for my husband and his love for me. That change in me reveals the depth of my relationship with my husband. And in the same way, the fruit of the Spirit in our lives reveals the depth of our relationship, can reveal the depth of our relationship with Christ. And here's a harsh reality that I want to lean into. It can be difficult to hear, but it's so important. So I'm just going to ask you guys to lean in here, to listen in here. I want you to take a second and think about your life. If you look at the scope of your life and you don't see any change, you don't see any transformation, if you don't see an inner desire to become more like Jesus, right? If you don't see yourself walking in step with the Spirit, I think we really need to evaluate whether we know him. I think we need to evaluate whether we actually have a relationship with Jesus, guys. Because the Bible promises us that when we say yes to Jesus, we're a new creation. We experience change. That is a part of the deal when we say yes to Jesus. Romans 6 tells us that we're either going to be slaves to the world or we're going to be slaves to Christ. And we get to choose. We get to choose who our master is. And the fruit of the Spirit in our lives reveals who our master is. And I really want to preface here, guys, perfection is not expected of us. It is impossible to do this walk with the Spirit perfectly. Perfection's not expected, but a life with Jesus is a transformed life. It is a changed life. So I'm asking you today, are you walking with the Spirit? Are you walking with the Spirit? Do you have a relationship with Jesus? Are you actively being changed? Or do we just show up on a Wednesday and we call it a day, right? Or we show up on a Sunday and we call it a day? I want you to ask yourself that question. Do I have a relationship with Jesus? It is the most important question that you could possibly ask yourself. Another reason why fruit matters is because the fruit of the Spirit is a demonstration of who Jesus is to the world around us. If you think about those qualities, love, joy, peace, do you see a lot of that in our world today? Do you see a lot of self-control in our world today? In a world that tells us, hey, you go after what's gonna make you happy. You do whatever you've gotta do to make your dreams come true. Do we see a lot of those qualities? Self-control, kindness, gentleness? No, right? I know I don't see a lot of those qualities in our culture today. So when we share the fruit of the Spirit with other people, we are like a bright light showing people who Jesus is. I think of it as like a lighthouse on this dark and stormy sea. It's like a source of hope for people. It's a sign that there is another way to live. There is another way besides what this culture is telling you, and that way is Jesus. The fruit of the Spirit matters because it's a demonstration to the world. It shows the world who Jesus is. And a second question you may be asking at this point is like, what does this fruit look like in our lives? Just on a day-to-day basis, what does it look like? Because we can list off these qualities, right? Love, joy, peace, patience. But what does that actively look like on a day-to-day basis? And I think it can show up in different ways in our lives in different seasons. I love to think about this, that Jesus has a plan specifically for you, for the fruit that he wants to bring about in your life. And it's based on your personality. It's based on your experiences. It's based on your background. Jesus has dreams for the specific fruits that he wants to develop in you. When I look at my life, I think Jesus from an early age has been developing this in me and continues to develop this in me. Because I'm such a big feeler, as I told you, I think Jesus has been developing in me over the years this ability to just like empathize with people, to sit and listen and cry with people, and celebrate in people. I think Jesus looked at me and said, that is something that I want to work on in you. And it's been such a gift to me. So I'm asking you today, what is the fruit of the Spirit that Jesus is developing in you? Based on specifically who you are and the uniqueness in which he made you. Take a minute and think about that. What fruit the Lord has developed during your life in you. And a third question we may be thinking at this point is just how? Like how do we develop fruit in our lives? Because we've covered that we can't do it on our own, right? We don't have the power to do it by ourselves. It's because of our connection to the vine, the power source, that we can create fruit. But what does that look like on a daily basis? How do we stay connected to the vine? And I want to demonstrate this. We're going to be kids for a second. I'm so excited. I need two volunteers who are wearing long pants. Two volunteers who are wearing, and they have to be the same gender. I'm going to do these two. Come on up, girls. Okay. Come on up, come on up. I need you to duct tape one of your legs together to each other. Here's what we're doing. This is just for me, honestly. I just want to force you guys to do this. We're three-legged racing today. Who has done a three-legged race? Raise your hand if that's something that you've done before. Okay, good. A good amount of you. I never have. I run away from three-legged races because I'm not athletic and I'm prone to falling down and I've broken two bones in the last like year. So that's why I'm forcing, don't go yet. Okay, that's why I'm forcing you ladies to do it. Basically, the way that the three-legged race works, they're already demonstrating it. These two have to move in sync with each other, in a rhythm with each other. And the effectiveness of how quickly they move is gonna be based on how in sync they are. So ladies, you're already in the middle of the stage, but what I'm gonna have you do is let's go, this way's further. So we're gonna have you go this way. When I say go, we are going to that stool. Please do not fall or break anything. As quickly and safely and effectively as possible. Are we ready? Go. Cheer them on. Let's go, let's go, let's go. Start over. One, two, three, go. There it is, there it is, there it is, there it is. Well done, give them a hand, give them a hand. Thank you, ladies. You may remove the tape and take a seat or break it or whatever you need to do that. That was just fun for me. And it's a little silly, but I think it really demonstrates what keeping in step with someone actually looks like, what keeping in step looks like. It's how we're designed to live, is keeping in step with the Holy Spirit, keeping in a rhythm with Him, keeping in sync with Him. It's through walking in step with the Spirit that we experience the change that we're designed to experience. And when you saw these two up here, I think there were a few factors that contributed to their success, or somewhat success at the beginning, but then you guys really turned it around. We're gonna talk about those few factors that contributed to their success. The first one was, I gotta make sure I'm getting the first one right. Yeah, okay. You need a basic understanding of how the human body works in order to do that effectively. You need to know, like, hey, we as people, we're gonna go one foot in front of the other. I know it sounds really simple, but it's important. We need to know, hey, I need to know how to distribute my weight in order to effectively move across the stage. You need to know the body. And in the same way, when it comes to keeping in step with the Spirit, we need to know who He is. We need to know who He is. We need to know how He operates, how He shows up in our lives. If we wanna keep in step with the Spirit, we need to know God. And that's why we stress, guys, the importance of, like, get in your Bible, come to church, be in community. That stuff matters, not to just check a box. It matters because it teaches us who God is, and it teaches us who we are. And it's through knowing those things that we can keep in step with Him. Second, they needed to communicate. I don't know if you saw them, but before you went, they were whispering to each other, kind of planning out how they were going to do it as they moved across the stage. Communication is so important, because if one person thought, okay, we're going to start with our shared leg, and the other person thought, okay, I'm going to start with my free leg, that's going to stop their progress really quickly. Might even end in a face plant. Communication really matters, so we need to be talking to God. We need to be talking with Him. We need to be in communion with Him. And I think sometimes it's difficult to discern what the voice of God sounds like when we pray, but there's a few things that we can really rely on. One, His voice is always gonna align with what we know to be true in the Bible. His voice is always gonna sound like those fruits of the Spirit. It's gonna be kind. It's gonna be loving. It's gonna be gracious. It's gonna be faithful. And it's also gonna align with everything we know to be true about who Jesus is and what He accomplished on the cross. To keep in step with the Holy Spirit, we need to talk with God. Simple. And finally, while they were moving across the stage, where were they looking? Forward, straight ahead, right? They were both looking in the same direction. Because if we want to keep in step with somebody, we need to have our eyes fixed on the same prize. We can't be looking, if one of them was looking backwards while they were trying to go, disaster, right? They had to keep their eyes fixed on the same place. And the same goes with keeping in step with the Holy Spirit. If He wants to work on something in you, Jesus has a dream for working on fruit in you. If they're like, okay, I really want to work on gentleness with this person. So we are headed towards gentleness. But you are so fixated on what is back here, on the anger that you're holding towards one of your friends, on someone that harmed you, on your frustration. You're so fixated on that. There's no way you're going to be able to keep in step with the Spirit and head towards the same goal. In order to keep in step with the Spirit, we have to have our eyes fixed on the prize. And it's worth mentioning also, guys, that bearing fruit in your life is gonna look different in different seasons. It's not always gonna look the same. Stephen described it to me as this, like, you're taking a walk with, like, a grandma in the park, arm in arm with a grandma or a grandpa, and you're following their leading, right? And every once in a while, they'll be like, it's time to stop. So you take a break. And they'll say, all right, it's time to go. Let's head in this direction. So you follow them. It's not always gonna be this race, right? You're gonna bear fruit in different ways in different seasons of your life, but the most important move is that you're following the Spirit's leading as you walk. So finally, guys, here at Mission Hills, we want you to become like Jesus and join Him on mission. That is our big goal. We want you to become like Jesus and join Him on mission. So as we close today and you head to your small groups, I want you to be thinking about this, okay? Where is the fruit in your life? Where is the evidence of God's work in your life? What are the practices and habits in your life? And are they creating fertile soil, good soil, for fruit to actually grow? If you believe in Jesus today, you are on a journey of transformation. You're gonna be changed. I can promise you that. If you don't believe in Jesus today, I just wanna tell you that change is available to you. You can be that lighthouse, that source of hope to a world that desperately needs to see Jesus. Jesus wants to change you. You can say yes to Him today. Or if you've been going to church maybe for a while and you're realizing, I don't actually know if I'm walking in step with the Holy Spirit. I don't know if I've actually said yes to Jesus, if I have a relationship with him, if you are questioning that today, talk to your small group leader. Talk to your small group leader. Say yes to Jesus. He offers you more. And the more that he offers, it's characterized by the fruit that we just read about. And if you've been attending on Wednesdays, you love Jesus for a while, I want you to be thinking about how we can keep in step with the Holy Spirit. How can we keep in step with the Holy Spirit today? How can we align our eyes on the same thing? How can we make sure we know who he is, that we're communicating with him? Because the grace of Jesus changes us. And we as a high school ministry want to pursue that change together. So let's pray. Lord, thank you for tonight, God. You're so good. You're so faithful. I thank you for the ways that you're bringing fruit in these students' lives, Lord. I thank you that you made them uniquely, Lord, and you have dreams for the fruit you want to bear in them. Thank you, Jesus, for your grace that changes us. It changed everything. Lord, we love you so much. Thank you for tonight. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
All I know.
right, a few quick announcements for you guys before you head to small groups. The first one is this. Summer camp signups are officially live. So check out Instagram, check out the website if you want more information. In addition to that, we have a special guest here with us who's going to share about an opportunity for you guys to serve this summer at a camp in Colorado. So there's going to be a quick video, and then she's going to share a little bit more about that. And then once she's done sharing, Peyton and Maya, whoever's, you guys will come up after Kayla. All right. So if you could roll that video, and then I'll pass things over to Kayla.
Like, this has been one of the best summers, probably the best summer that I've had ever.
When I talk to my friends who've been home all summer, you know, their stories are, yeah, I laid out by the pool a lot, and I watched a lot of TV, and I don't think there's a day here I haven't accomplished a large amount of the Lord's work. And I love looking back at the end of the summer and thinking, I didn't waste my time, because the Lord gave us this life, and I don't want to waste it.
So I've been here all summer, and so, like, at first I was kind of bitter about it. I was like, man, I'm about to spend my entire summer in Colorado, away from my family, away from my friends, without my phone. But it's actually been, like, the most amazing experience ever. I got to grow deeper in my faith. I got to learn how to be a true man in Christ. I got to mature and act like an adult, not a 12-year-old. I got to learn so many great and amazing things, meet so many great and amazing people. And these are gonna be things that I'm gonna carry with me, you know, 20 years down the road, 30 years down the road.
I love it so much. I would never trade it for anything else in the world. God has made this program truly amazing, and I could not ask for anything better. It's really taught me so many things about serving and just loving others in a way that no other place could express. There is hope for me, yeah, because God won't forget all the plans He's made for me. Being in the SALT program means that I'm part of a team, and that no matter if I'm tired or if I'm dead, I still have to work hard and give my best and serve God in all that I do. I have been through like a lot of things at home, and this SALT program has given me tools to deal with that. And not only that, it's given me a family and also like a relationship to the community that the Bible talks about that we need to build our faith.
I am definitely so much closer to God than I was at the beginning of the summer. I thought I was coming in and I thought I was close to God, and He really showed me that how much closer I could be.
All right, can you guys give a warm welcome to Kayla, who's going to share a little bit more about the SALT program and ways you guys could get involved.
All right, thanks guys for having me here. My name is Kayla Costley. I supervise the SALT program up at Camp Idrahaji in Bailey. SALT stands for Service and Leadership Training. And you just saw a video of people who have been part of the SALT program and the things that they learned, the ways that they've grown, what God did through it. So I would love to invite you guys to be part of the program. It's for 15 to 17-year-olds. So I know some of you are seniors. If you are, we do have paid positions for you. You can come talk to me if you're interested in that. But for the rest of you, SALT is a 5-week program, 4 weeks plus a week of staff training. You're helping out in the kitchens. You're working as an assistant counselor, counselor in training. Getting lots of opportunities to grow in your service, to grow in your leadership. You get to pour into campers, but you also get to be poured into by myself and some of our other staff. So if you want more information, I'll be hanging around. I would love to talk to any of you, answer any questions you might have. And also there's some flyers going around as well as a sign-up sheet. If you want more information, you can write your name down. The flyers have a link to our website, which has a little bit more information, as well as a link to our application. So spots are filling up. So if you're interested, I would encourage you to apply. I would love to consider any of you for the program. Maddie, who's up here in the front, Maddie has been a SALT in the past, so you could also talk to her about her experience. I'm sure she would love to share how she grew and how much she enjoyed her time in SALT. So thanks again, guys, for having me. And I would love for you guys to be part of our SALT program this summer. And I'll be around if you have questions or want to talk more.
Great, thanks Kayla. All right, one final announcement. If I could have some El Salvador team members come on up. We have a great opportunity in a couple of weeks to be a part of a fundraiser 2 weeks from now. So if you guys could share a little bit more about that, and then once they're done sharing, it'll be time for small groups. Give it up for Peyton.
Hey, guys. And Parker and Ariel, yeah! Okay, all right. Okay, well, we're going to El Salvador this summer, as you may know by now. But in 2 weeks, we're doing a fundraiser, and for dinner rather than Chick-fil-A, we're gonna be selling burritos. So it's just $5 burritos in 2 weeks. So yeah, that's all.
Give it up for burritos! What'd you say, Parker?
My mom is making the beans. They'll be tasty. Trust me.
They'll be great. So encourage you guys 2 weeks from now, join us for dinner, specifically buy some burritos to support El Salvador. That covers it. Head to small groups. We'll see you guys soon.
The fruit of the spirit is not a coconut. Fruit of the spirit's not a coconut. If you wanna be a coconut, you might as well hear it. You can't be a fruit of the spirit, cause the fruit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and gentleness, and self-control. Oh, the fruit of the spirit's not a banana. The fruit of the spirit's not a banana. You wanna be a banana? You might as well hear it. You can't be a fruit of the spirit, cause the fruit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and gentleness, and self-control. Oh, the fruit of the spirit's not a watermelon. The fruit of the spirit's not a watermelon. You wanna be a watermelon? You might as well hear it. You can't be a fruit of the spirit, cause the fruit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and gentleness, and self-control. Oh, the fruit of the spirit's not a lemon. The fruit of the spirit's not a lemon. If you wanna be a lemon, you might as well hear it. You can't be a fruit of the spirit, cause the fruit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and gentleness, and self-control. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and gentleness, and self-control. Oh, the fruit of the spirit's not a cherry. The fruit of the spirit's not a cherry. If you wanna be a cherry, you might as well hear it. You can't be a fruit of the spirit, cause the fruit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and gentleness, and self-control. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and gentleness, and self-control. Okay! Everybody knows that grapes come in bunches, so everybody get in big bunches! The fruit of the spirit's not a grape! The fruit of the spirit's not a grape! You wanna be a grape? You might as well hear it. You can't be a fruit of the spirit, cause the fruit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and gentleness, and self-control. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and gentleness, and self-control. The fruit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and gentleness, and self-control. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and gentleness, and self-control. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and gentleness, and self-control. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and gentleness, and self-control.